Today we're talking about the Afghanistan peace process, because in a piece of news so far out of right field it's coming from the stands, the AP just reported that the United States and the Taliban have agreed to a temporary truce that, if successful, would open the way for a deal that would bring American troops home from Afghanistan and end 18 years of war. Hey, turns out some news is good news. Now I know what some of you guys are thinking, negotiating with the Taliban. That's gotta be an exercise in futility. Okay, we hear you, death to America. But how about just crippling America? I mean, have you looked at our healthcare and economic policies recently? We're trying to meet you halfway here. In reality, things seem to be going well. In part because America and the Taliban have one common goal. Getting America the heck out of Afghanistan. Today my goal is to explain what the newest peacemaking process looks like and some of the problems that have yet to be debated between America, the Taliban, and the government of Afghanistan. First, let's talk about scheduling. Ooh, starting with the Google Calendar. This guy knows how to bump up excitement. So we have this temporary truce that's currently active and can be basically summarized by the coexist bumper sticker. For the next 10 days, America's gonna leave our troops here, you leave your troops there, and we don't shoot at each other. If peace is the end goal, that sounds like as good a starting point as any. If this de-escalation holds, it will inaugurate an 130-day drawdown of United States troops, from the current 13,000 to 8,600. Now, I crunched the numbers on this, and 8,600 is still 8,600 more than zero. So the story doesn't end there. It is in fact the next step that's where all the excitement really starts, because this was, at least in theory, a huge breakthrough. The Taliban official said the signing had been tentatively set for February 29th, with the start of the Afghan talks planned for March 10th. That's right, set your calendars, because starting March 10th, we're putting the Afghan and Taliban leaders into a room together to, you know, catch up a bit, share some coffee, and figure out how to run the country post-America. This is huge. To understand the significance of this, we need to travel back in time a bit, because the war in Afghanistan is a bit of a military turducken. There was a full-blown civil war raging before America and coalition forces decided to stick ourselves right up in there. Before 9/11, the Taliban controlled the vast majority of Afghanistan, and America's friend, the Northern Alliance, were on the ropes. Luckily for the Northern Alliance, after 9/11, the Taliban refused to hand over bin Laden. So we invaded and kind of got distracted from the whole let's get bin Laden goal and ended up destroying the Taliban government and establishing the Northern Alliance as the official government of Afghanistan. Because of this, getting the Taliban to negotiate and establish a government with this Northern Alliance that is now occupying, well, North, South, East, and West, and Middle, would be like trying to get a longtime employee and next in line for the corporate leadership position to try to negotiate the future of the company with Chad, the owner's son. Well, the government of Afghanistan has been very eager to talk to the Taliban, as they're currently negotiating with a wall while America talks to the Taliban. The Taliban have been less than enthusiastic about talking to the government of Afghanistan. The Taliban have long been resistant to sitting down with what they see as a puppet of the US government. Okay, great, your dad's probably gonna give you the company. But he's right over there. I'm gonna talk to him, not you. Besides, if he passes before you've established control and legitimacy, well, there's gonna be a hostile takeover. Now this is why it's so significant that we finally got these two groups in the room and negotiating a post-America compromise constitution for the country. And all it took was America providing for the release of 5,000 Taliban prisoners before the start of the negotiations. Oh boy, we're really paying cash up front for this one. At this point, most of the future plans beyond that point hinge on the success level of these inter-Afghanistan talks. So that's the schedule. We're currently in a ceasefire. On February 29th, we will sign an 130-day withdrawal agreement, removing 44,000 troops. And then on March 10th, the inter-Afghanistan peace talks will begin. Now to the bigger question, what will those negotiations look like? Well, that's where things continue to be tricky, because the Taliban are about as woke as Rip Van Winkle after four Tylenol PMs. The government of Afghanistan has made quite a few strides in women's rights and such, while in control. It's pretty hard to compromise with. No school for girls, no jobs for women, transgressors were stoned and flogged. Yeah, next time you fly out to negotiate with the Taliban, don't forget to set your watch back 200 years. Because we're writing a constitution here though, there are some major questions about basic protected human rights and the level of democratic values that will be represented. One side wants an equal rights republic and the other side wants an Islamic emirate. Whew, this is going to be a long negotiation. Interestingly enough though, the deputy of the Taliban's Minister of Justice recently said, "You've accepted Saudi Arabia, and we won't do more than their basic code. Retribution for murder. Chop off the hand for robbing. If you've accepted Saudi Arabia, what's wrong with us being another? The rest will be your priorities. Aid, friendship, economic relations." Now, before we move on, because wow, I want to emphasize that there's a large gulf between the rights protected in Saudi Arabia's constitution and the rights that are distributed by the booked laws that have been passed since the adoption of their constitution. It's like looking at Joaquin Phoenix and Jared Leto both pulling from the same source material for the Joker. Yeah, it's the same starting point, but what matters is what you do with it. One won an Oscar and the other sent used condoms to a bunch of people. Need I say more? Afghan lawmakers working under a Saudi Arabian constitution would still yield a very different result than Saudi Arabia. And it's not a good sign when Saudi Arabia is the human rights best case scenario. On the other side, Taliban leaders have been invited to participate in the democratic process. And, you know, see if their ideas can get people to the polls. This would be a much simpler solution because the system already exists. And hey, if you're as popular as you think you are, you'll win. Unfortunately, the Taliban aren't exactly chomping at the bit to participate in that system. They seem to have really latched onto the idea of having a dynastic kingdom or emirate. Trying to make that fit into a democracy is like pushing a square peg through a solid block of wood. So, if that's the case, why is America trying to end the Afghan civil war by getting both sides to sit down and sing kumbaya? Well, it seems increasingly likely that when America finally withdraws, if we don't resolve the underlying civil war, we're going to end up in a Vietnam-style situation where the government we back falls. This definitely limits our options to leveraging our troop withdrawals to get the most liberal constitutional compromise we can get the Taliban to agree to, and then making sure they stick to it. Or stay in the course and hoping that if we keep beating the Taliban back, maybe in another 18 years or so, they might be in a weak enough position that they'd have to give up more ground in the negotiations. Or lastly, we could just slowly back out of the country and let the civil war play out the way it was before we invaded in 2001. All the while hoping that we created a government there that's strong enough to defend itself. So those are the most recent breakthroughs in the Afghan peace process. We currently have a ceasefire that, as of the writing of this episode, is actually being followed by both sides. We have a withdrawal agreement that will be signed by the US and the Taliban leaders in 8 days if peace continues. And in just over a month, we will have the first official meeting between the Taliban and Afghan governments. It's an exciting but nerve-wracking time. As the Washington Post reports, the Afghan peace process plan floated here this weekend is an election year gamble. If it works, President Trump can claim credit for ending America's longest conflict. But if Trump is seen as rushing for the exit, he could trigger a renewed Afghan civil war. So that's exactly what's going on with the Afghan peace process right now. Sounds like, for the time being, we're gonna keep fighting for peace. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello, YouTube. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan news, remember to subscribe by clicking on this floating logo to the right of my head. Ring that bell so that freedom will continue to ring, and give me a thumbs up if you like what you saw. Lastly, as always, thank you for watching.